Hello everyone, and welcome back to my channel, and welcome to my very first video of 2020. Now this video is going to be a time lapse of a really beautiful rose that I found that I wanted to capture in color pencil. If you are curious about any of the materials that I used, please check the description box down below. I'll have all of them linked for you, but I will also talk about them a little bit throughout this video. Now, when I got started with this drawing, I knew that I wanted to draw it by hand. This drawing was a very complicated one. I am not someone who does a lot of drawings when it comes to things being really complex, but it's something that I made a goal to work on starting back in October, and was something that I wanted to continue to work on throughout this year. So I wanted to start with this rose drawing, and I'm not gonna lie, it took me a really long time. I worked on this drawing over the course of several days and many pieces of paper and lots of anger and frustration when I wasn't able to get it right. I'm someone who likes to do all of my drawings by hand. I don't like to trace anything. I feel like drawing it by hand not only increases my skill as an artist, it improves my hand control, and I also believe that it helps me build a better basis of knowledge when it comes to drawing things in the future, and also allow me to have something that is a little bit more unique in my drawings. I feel like as you learn and grow and as you draw, you kind of learn that your hand moves in a very specific way, in a way that is very telling to who the artist is, and I feel like that when you are drawing something by hand, that it can kind of help pull all of your pieces together. So that's just why I like to do it. And it really helped me to kind of go through and start off with drawing the individual petal shapes and not paying attention to the fact that it was a flower. But once I got the shape of the petal that I really wanted, to go through and shade it so that I could see a little bit more depth and weight of that individual petal on the paper. And it really helped me to kind of form the rest of the flower shape around that as I went. When I first started out, I wasn't doing any of the shading, and everything just kind of got lost and weird, and it was really hard to define where the shapes were and what petal I was on, and it really became too easy to get lost, especially since some of these shapes were petal shapes, some of them were creases, and some of them were shadow areas that I wanted to keep track of. So once I was done and I was really happy with my drawing, I ended up transferring it to a nicer piece of paper. Again, this wasn't something that I wanted to do. I like to do my original drawings on the paper that I'm going to be using, but it's a lot easier with other mediums like watercolor. If you're working with color pencil, if you have all of these creased lines in the paper, then your color pencil will skip over that. Color pencil, it's really important for the medium to stick to the tooth of the paper, and if you have these really deep lines going through it, then you're going to just kind of draw over it and you'll have these white spaces, and it makes it more difficult to layer, to get pigment there, and to just work with that all together. So I knew that I wanted a clean drawing, and I wanted it to be done really lightly on my nicer sheet of paper. So I did end up transferring that drawing, and I also knew that since I wasn't going to transfer any of my shadow lines, I went through and I did place a grid over my drawing so that I would have a better idea of where I was. Now, this drawing was done on a student grade paper. It's the Canson Montfall paper, and for anyone who asks, that is a watercolor paper. It's cold press. It is not a 100% cotton paper. That is something that I do want to try in the future and try their 100% cotton line, but I'm really just getting back into color pencils, so that's something that I haven't invested in yet. But it does have a good bit of tooth to it, and it's really up to you on whether or not you are going to like that or not if you try this paper. I've always used the Canson XL media paper, mixed media paper, and I really enjoy it. That was the paper that I could afford all while growing up and while in school, and for a lot of my early time as an artist. I used that paper for a lot of years. So I'm very familiar with it, and color pencil was the medium that I used for the longest time. So that's just what I like. I like that tooth and I like that texture to it. So if you don't like the mixed media paper from Canson, then you may not love this one. You may want something with a little less tooth. I did go through and I wanted to get a really good idea of what color pencil colors I would be using. I used a mix of Prismacolor Premier pencils. I did go through and take out all of the ones that I knew would not be light fast, since I knew that there were so many colors that I was missing that I would really want. I did decide to get another set of color pencils. This was a really big decision, and it was something that I did a lot of research on and what I felt would be best for my own needs, and I ended up settling on Faber-Castell Polychromos. And what I really loved was that I only had to get rid of two pencils from that set that weren't going to be light fast. And so that left me with a lot of colors to really fill out the rest of my collection. And then I did end up deciding on getting just a couple of colors that were from Caran d'Ache that were more like specialty colors, more unique colors, like that really nice light orange color that wasn't something that I had in any of the other lines. So that really helped me get the overall color that I wanted for this more corally rose drawing. Since I was improvising a little bit on the color of this rose, I was really using my reference image for the shape of it, and to show me where the shadows and the highlights would be and the folds. But the color I ended up with the final drawing of this was not the color that was in the original picture. And I really like that. I think the color is just so pretty. Now, to get started with the actual coloring of the flower, like I said, this took me a really long time. Just the coloring of it took me almost 17 hours, and that is not including the time that I spent off camera fixing some of the blends that I had, and also cleaning up some of the lines, since I do have this kind of overhead rig for filming, and I have lights around me. I can't sit at an angle that I really like. I'm the type of person who likes to sit really hunched over my artwork in my desk in a what most people would probably find to be really uncomfortable, but that's just how I like to sit, because it allows me to sit with my face 3 inches from my paper and just really get immersed into it, and I have to sit much further back. And I really like getting all of those really crisp, clean lines, and just really, really kind of getting up into all of the nooks and crannies of the drawing. So when I got into actually coloring the piece, I did want to start off with the color that would be the base layer for all of the drawing. I knew that it was going to be this kind of nice peachy orange, corally pink color, and it would kind of bounce back and forth between both of those depending on the lighting that was in that particular spot. So I really wanted to get started with just a mid-tone color as I was putting down my color pencil and work from there. I also wanted to start from the center of the flower because that was the area that really made the most sense to me. It had smaller, more condensed sections, and I'm really used to working smaller. As I started getting into the larger petals, it was a little bit more difficult for me to work out what I was doing and where I was, and it was an issue that I had because I did start this drawing once prior to this, and I started on the outermost petals and was going to work my way in, and I realized that when it comes to colored pencil, one of the things that you have to kind of get an idea of is how much layering you have to do. This is easier if you have a harder hand when you're putting down your color pencil and you're leaving more pigment behind, but I knew that I had a lot of colors and pigments that I wanted to put down on the paper. So when it came to, you know, getting the colors right, but also getting a really smooth blend, I rushed it, and it was something that I really felt that I needed to work up to. So with the first drawing, I was probably about 3 hours in, and then I decided that I was going to redo it, which really kind of stunk, I'm not gonna lie. It was a little discouraging, but I really feel like with the second piece, it gave me some lessons that I really needed, and it really helped me pay more attention to all of the variations within the petal, the areas that were in highlight and in shadow, how I wanted to convey those shadows, and really play around with where I wanted the colors to be. I found this to be a really intuitive process. It's not something that I feel like I could easily explain, but I had all of my colors laid out on my table. I had, I couldn't even tell you, dozens of colors. And it was really just a process of going through and picking a color that I felt like was what I needed and layering it and going from my, you know, darks to lights or lights to dark, depending on what I had, and putting it down really intentionally so that I could get the colors right, but also the areas that needed to be blended and the areas that needed to be creased a little bit more the way they needed to be. And from there, it was just grabbing the color that I felt like best, that was closest to what I needed to accomplish from there. So if I had a really dark color and I was blending it to a lighter color, then I would probably grab a mid-tone after that. And it's definitely hard to explain. Like I said, it's really more of an intuitive process. And I feel like the only way to really learn that is by doing it. And you kind of start to realize, you know, where you are in your drawing and what colors you need to get the effects that you want and to get the blends that you want. So that was really what I was doing throughout the whole drawing, is just kind of grabbing what I needed. So it's really hard to tell you like exactly what colors I used because there were just so many. But I really stuck with a lot of, you know, kind of dark, pretty, moody purples and reds for the shadows, and then moved up to light oranges and pinks and cream colors. And then for the highlights, I used like cream and ivory and white, and this really beautiful, like, light peachy pink color, and just kept cycling through those. I also used some really nice bright pink colors to get some of the different shadows and transitions, and I really like how it came out, and it was interesting to see on such a granular level all of the different nuances between all of the petals that were there. And like I said, this was a process that I did very slowly. When I'm going through, I like to keep the tips of my pencil really sharp because it helps to get into the tooth of the paper. It's really easy, especially if you have a blunt tip, to just stick to the surface of where that tooth is, and it's hard to really get into the paper, and that's how you end up seeing a lot of that white space. So having a pencil that was sharper helped to get better coverage, and just working in really, really small kind of circular motions, going from my darkest area and then working out, and really trying to be mindful of getting really nice coverage over that area and create really smooth transitions, because it can be really difficult if you make this really kind of harsh dark mark over an area that's supposed to be light to go through and correct that later on. But as I kind of hinted at, as I started to work my way out throughout this drawing, I did find that the larger sections were a little bit more difficult for me to kind of wrap my head around. As I normally work with smaller sections, it's a lot easier to get that buildup of pigment to get the section the way you want it to get it to a point where it's really easy to blend and you have the gradients the way that you want and you have the amount of pigment that you need to really start burnishing in a successful manner, especially with the polychromos. Like, this is the first project that I've done with these. Like, I'm not used to polychromos. They're a much harder lead, and they take a little bit to get used to. That was something that I wasn't really prepared for, I think, in some ways, but I ended up really loving them by the end. I loved that they stayed sharp for a really long time. They were really easy to get into, like, the nooks and crannies of the paper, but they don't have that creaminess that I'm used to with the Prismacolor Premier colored pencils, where you can really, really blend them out. Like, it's almost effortless. And I really do like Prismacolor color pencils. I wish that more of them were light safe to use in stuff like that. And I also want to try to find colored pencils that have that creaminess to them. So if you have like a favorite that you think that I should check out, let me know, because I would like to try to fill out my collection with stuff that's maybe a little bit more similar to that. Or even colors that are kind of a little bit more odd. That's something that I'm also looking for as well. But as I got into like those larger sections, I found that it took more time to build it up, and I didn't have the patience I needed for it. And that's not to say that I was being impatient, that like I wanted to get it done. Like I was done with this piece. I didn't want to do it anymore. I just wanted to kind of move on to the next thing, because while with the last like two or three petals that was the case, that wasn't how I was feeling. I was really enjoying the process of learning how to use these supplies, and the process of creating it and working on something a little bit bigger, and really just kind of being present in what I was learning and what I was doing. And I really loved this piece, and I loved how it was coming out, and I knew that I wanted to spend the time on it. But when it comes to not having the patience, it was more of I didn't realize how much further I had to go. And it was me not having that experience with those larger sections and how I usually work. So I wasn't putting down the amount of pigment and the amount of layers that I needed for it to be really smooth. That was something that I had to build up to. And I found that with those really large petals, it really did take a long time. It was a lot of work, and it was a lot of me kind of taking a step back and realizing that what I was doing, I wasn't ready for yet. Like, if I started blending it out too early, you could kind of see that maybe it was a little bit more kind of pixely looking, and it didn't have that creaminess that the center of it had. So being a little bit more mindful was really helpful in that. And I feel like starting with those smaller sections and working my way out, and having a project that took so long to complete, it helped me be a little bit more mindful over time. And that was kind of what I spent some of my time off camera doing, when I realized that I had left a section not as complete as I would have liked, not as smooth or as creamy as I would have liked. That was some stuff that I did off camera, because I realized once I kind of came back to it that it wasn't as nice as I wanted it to be. And that's what I had to work on. And I really found with this paper having a lot more tooth to it, it could handle a ton of layers. I didn't count, and I have no intention on counting like how many layers I was able to get with the color pencil, but even when it was at the point to where you would think it's so waxy, there's so much buildup, there's so much, you know, pigment and color pencil here that it really can't fit anymore, I found that I was still able to make minor corrections to it. But on the flip side of that, I also thought it was kind of difficult to get the burnishing the way that I liked. Since it still could hold more pigment, I was able to cover up some of the colors that I really liked how they were, like those really, really dark purples in the shadows. I liked how those came out, but if I tried to burnish them with a color that was too light, I lightened that whole area. And the same thing when I was working in areas that were really light. You know, if I had a section that was supposed to be almost white and I went in with like an ivory or a cream, I ended up making it a little bit too dark, and I had to kind of go back over and fix that. So luckily it allowed me to do that, but I learned that when I was trying to really blend it out, that I had to be careful and I had to be mindful and I had to use a lot more colors to kind of go through and get the blend and the look that I wanted in a way that was a lot more strategic than I'm used to working on. So that was something that I learned throughout this piece. And another thing that I thought was kind of interesting about this flower was that the very outside petals were much darker than the ones that were on the inside. And that was something that I didn't really love. Like, I wanted the whole piece to look kind of cohesive. And even in the reference image, I found that it looked a little disjointed almost. Like, the petals, the very, very outside petals looked like they were maybe like wilting or withering or kind of dying, and I really wanted it to look like a really kind of early bloom flower. So I did try to take that color discrepancy in mind when I was doing it. I think I made them look a little bit more pinky than the rest of the flower to maybe show that they are the outside, they are a little bit older, they have maybe been through a little bit more, that they're maybe dying and they're going to fall off soon. I wanted that to be like a little bit different. So I did focus on them being a little bit more pinky, but not as far gone as maybe the reference image would have had me do if I were to follow it completely. So I really like that I did that, and I feel like it still kind of conveys that thought, but I'm glad that I didn't take it as far. And I also noticed that as I worked my way out, there was a lot more like darker pigmentation on the outside of the petals, and that was something that was a little bit more difficult to work on. I did have a hard time kind of focusing on where that was going to be and blending it out, but also not making it like so blended. So it was a lot of figuring out how I was going to follow the reference image and how I was going to stray from it. And that's another thing that I feel like it just kind of takes time to learn as you go. And I'm really happy with how it came out. I do feel like I need a little bit more practice when it comes to those larger areas. And I do have to say that after this, I think I'm ready to, you know, jump into watercolor a little bit again, because this took so much time compared to watercolor pieces. And I kind of really like the solid color of watercolor and how easy it is to get blends and add texture, and you really don't have to blend them all out the way that I like them to be in color pencil, so that I kind of miss. But I do kind of like how it can be a little bit easier with color pencil to get some like weird texture that is a little bit harder to get. Like, you can kind of notice up close in some of the petals that it has this almost veiny look to it. And I feel like if you're someone who likes doing skin tones, being able to get those really slight lines of color, that kind of veiny look to it as you're coloring and blending out, it adds such a life to your drawings. And I really liked that in some of the petals in here. And I know that if I were to have tried to do that with watercolor, it would have added an effect that I wouldn't have wanted. So that was something that I didn't expect. I didn't remember that from using color pencil prior to this, but it was fun to kind of rediscover. And I'm really excited to look for more ways to use that going forward. And I also really like the idea of maybe exploring some of the weirder differences between like color pencil and watercolor in a future video, because I do think that at least for me and how like my brain works, there are certain things that just end up looking a lot nicer if you pick one medium or the other. So I'm thinking that might be something that I want to talk about or do in the future. And I think right now we're getting kind of to the end of this time lapse. I know that this was long and chatty. I know that I probably wandered a little bit, but I also hope that you kind of like this more chatty style voiceover where I'm just talking about the piece and my thought process behind it. And really whatever weird thing kind of comes to my mind. I know some people really don't like those over-edited voiceovers, and I have some people say that I sound almost robotic, and it's because I'm always thinking about cutting out the weird, you know, vocal glitches that every single person does in a conversation, but you don't notice until you're actually listening to yourself on camera, and you're just really, really annoyed by your own voice and all of the weird quirks that you have. So I'm going to try to just be a little bit more human going forward in my voiceovers, and I hope that you don't mind that. that is all for this video, and I hope that you really liked it. I look forward to making more videos in the future and going back to my weekly upload schedule. If you like this video, I hope you give it a thumbs up, or leave a comment to let me know, or subscribe to my channel. That always makes me super happy, and I will see you all next week. Bye!